It's interesting looking at the people who are perhaps best with numbers being back in the cabinet. Gavin Williamson, a huge organiser and another former chief whip. Mark Harper, a former chief whip, as you mentioned. And indeed, Mr. Spreadsheet himself, Grant Shapps, now running the business department. I suppose having all of those organisers in the tent is probably a wise thing. But what can all of these appointments tell us about the ideological direction of this government? There's some appointments that people can say, oh, this is a government of the right. There's others where people would say, well, this is a big tack to the left. What can we take from it all?
I think Rishi Sunak has tried to sort of drag the cabinet back to the centre ground. He hasn't tacked to the left or too much to the right, but he's sort of done away with the hard right, if you like, that Liz Truss had for 7 weeks. So it has sort of brought it back to the centre ground, which is, of course, where most elections are won. He yesterday as well spoke about the 2019 election-winning manifesto, which Boris Johnson, when he tried to make a comeback over the weekend, he sort of tied himself to that and said that basically it was his manifesto. He got the mandate when he won that thumping majority, remember, of 80 common seats back in December 2019. But Rishi Sunak wanted to highlight that no one person owned that manifesto. It was a Conservative Party manifesto. Now, by doing that and claiming that as his mandate, and of course, there's no constitutional reason or need for a general election, despite the fact that a majority of voters seem to want one. By tying himself to it, he does sort of tie himself to a lot of the pledges in it as well, many of which have already been binned, and some of which, in the aftermath of COVID, of course, may look unaffordable.
And many of which he binned himself as Chancellor, not least the national insurance tax hike, and I suppose the spirit of the corporation tax hike, because the manifesto spoke of the 19% rate as something that was internationally competitive. I do wonder, though, if this government is casting itself as one of the centre ground, as one of the grown-ups, as a lot of people around Rishi Sunak like to describe themselves, how is that a big difference to where the Labour Party is now positioning itself? Are we going to see at midday today, at Prime Minister's Questions, two pretty boring, pretty centrist, pretty technocratic individuals, a mirror image of one another?
Yes, is the short answer to that. I do think that PMQs is going to be dull for a while. And people on the Conservative Party, they'll appreciate that because you look how far behind they are in the polls. They want a bit of dullness, a bit of sobriety at the top of government. It does make it difficult for Labour leader Sir Keir Starmer because, you know, when he was up against Boris Johnson at noon every Wednesday, he was able to set very clear dividing lines as the sort of sober, boring, if you like, leader of the opposition against this sort of flamboyant, bamboozling Prime Minister. Mm. There were two big contrasts there. We never really got a sense of how Keir Starmer and Liz Truss would go up against each other on a regular basis because necessarily it was a very short premiership for Liz Truss. So I think what we see today, it will be sort of relatively sober, yes, probably quite technocratic. There might be, you know, an exchange of numbers. There'll be a lot of number crunching, I would have thought. Mm. And you know, it's quite interesting thinking once Cabinet breaks up in the next sort of few minutes, Rishi Sunak will have his advisers around him prepping him for PMQs before he heads over to Parliament for noon.